Alright guys, as promised in my original video of the RTX 2080, I'm also bringing you an overclocking video of that graphics card. And what I can say right away is, by overclocking the 2080, you can squeeze out quite a bit of extra power from it. It is really worth it in my opinion, definitely. The gap between the 2080 and 2080 Ti therefore does get a little bit smaller at least. And today I'm gonna show you how you can do the overclock yourself in very few simple steps. However, for those looking for extreme overclocking, well, you're at the wrong place. I'll only overclock in a manner that practically wouldn't void the warranty. Now, it actually doesn't really matter what RTX 2080 model you have. It works with all of them, no matter if it's the Founders Edition directly by Nvidia or aftermarket models by one of the board partners like Gigabyte, ASUS, MSI and so on. There, however, are minor differences, which I'll talk about in a second. In my case, I'll be overclocking the Gigabyte RTX 2080. The Windforce OC 8G edition. So, what kind of tools do we need for this? Well, that's basically up to you. One of the most popular tools would either be the MSI Afterburner or EVGA's Precision X1. Since I, however, own a Gigabyte card and already have installed Gigabyte's own Aorus engine software for the RGB lighting control, I'll be using that one. It more or less offers the same functionality as the others do. After all, I don't want two separate tools starting up with Windows, one for the lighting control and the other for the GPU clock. Admittedly, the Aorus engine is far from perfect, but it'll do for now. Before I touch any dials, I usually like checking what my GPU clock is at stock, basically how far GPU boost already takes my card. So that's some sort of a reference point for me, which you can either do in-game or, if you like it extreme, do a stress test for instance with Furmark. At stock settings, my card averages at about 1665 MHz with Furmark running in the background. The memory is sitting at a constant 1750 MHz. Usually, the very first thing you increase is the power target as well as the temp target. Both need to be at their max. In my case, I've linked them, so it's 108% and 88 degrees Celsius respectively. And very important, in fact, is the power target. On default, the card is allowed to draw exactly 100% of power the manufacturer had in mind. That's voltage. Now, by going up to 108% in my case, I am allowing my whole card to draw 8% more power, more voltage that all goes to the GPU, memory or fans. So just as with CPUs, by doing that, this would allow us to achieve higher clock speeds. Some cards allow more than 108%, others even less than that. The higher you can go on the power target, the better chance you have for a decent overclock, without going for any warranty avoiding hardware mods. And since we are only given 8% more juice to work with, we have to distribute it wisely, meaning you have to experiment for the perfect balance between GPU and memory clock. A high GPU clock alone won't do any wonders, and vice versa with memory. Manually tinkering with the voltage unfortunately hasn't been allowed by Nvidia, so we have to live with what we've got, the power target. The limiting factor with overclocking is always the power delivery, the voltage. We always keep running into power limits. Now, so we don't actually run into the temperature limit, I'd recommend increasing the fan speed at a specific temperature level. Do not go for the maximum. If you have a good cooler, that's not necessary. That would only eat up precious power that could be put to good use for maintaining a higher GPU and or memory clock. Once my GPU reaches 61 degrees, I decided to let the fan spin at 65%. That should do. The fan curve for sure could be tweaked, however. And yeah, the perfect combination in my case was a GPU core clock increase of 140 MHz and 500 MHz on the memory. With Furmark running in the background, my 2080 is running at about 1830 MHz on average and a solid 1813 MHz on the memory. That's an improvement for sure. Very important to know is that not every RTX 2080 will actually clock as high and would be able to run stable at my exact settings. So only take my settings as a reference point. I'm also certain I could have gone a little higher had I invested just a bit more time. But how much does such an overclock actually affect the gaming performance? Let's take a look. So without the slightest doubt, there are noticeable performance gains all across the board in all my tests. All that with that simple overclock. So as you can see, this is free performance waiting for you. It can be worth it to take your time and tweak your RTX 2080 a little. You can squeeze out a bit of extra performance for sure. But of course, don't expect huge gains. That would be just unrealistic. And despite the overclock on the 2080, you still won't be able to catch up to a 2080 Ti with it, by far not. Nonetheless, a bit of extra free performance is always nice to have. Sure, with the increased power target, we do see a slightly higher power draw, but in my case, those were just 10 watts, which is negligible on a card like this. And the temperatures are perfectly fine. With that WindForce cooler, I reached like 66 degrees under full load. That's even lower than at stock settings, but only because I've increased the fan speed to 65%, that is. The card certainly can take more degrees easily, so if you like things to be a bit quieter, you could lower the fan speed a little. At the end of the day, it comes down to your cooling design. I can only speak for my Gigabyte WindForce OC version. To sum things up, I'd say the RTX 2080 is waiting to be overclocked. There certainly are performance gains to be seen that do make a difference, depending on what graphics settings you're playing at. So in terms of overclocking, aside from the locked voltage slider, the RTX 2080 deserves a big thumbs up from me. I in fact would also love seeing one like that on my video. And as always, thanks for watching.